I assume the slides will come on out, or is the organization poor? Yeah. Okay. It's a good start.
Yes.
This time in color as well, so this will be an exciting presentation. Thank you, Arnold. Yeah. Do you also want to say what I have to say, or? Okay. It's a great pleasure, Arnold, to be asked back after 7 years. So maybe 7 years is long enough for Arno to forget what a mess I made out of my first contribution and how upset everybody was after that contribution. So maybe I will do the same, or I'll show that I mellowed a bit over the time. We'll see. I'm not quite sure what I will be saying yet, because I've been given a very broad title: the past, the present, and the future. So I can do whatever I want, but I can be very short about the past. The past sucks, in my opinion. The present is quite all right, and the future will be even brighter. And after 25 years, I think I'm in a position, after 25 years in the industry, I think I'm in a position to make a few comments on the past, how we got to where we are now, and what I believe we should be concentrating on for the future. But before I do that, I'll start with something completely different. The European Commission is also here today, I saw in the program and in the list of participants. And the European Commission was also already mentioned by Michael in his remarks. And it's probably fair to say that in this room there's quite a few people who sometimes moan and groan about the European Commission. But I would like to be, for once, be more positive, because the comments that the European Commission doesn't listen are no longer true. Because, I mean, not everybody in the European Commission is listening. There are some Irish names that refuse to listen. And I think, Michael, if you're up to your job, you make sure she is here next year and that I don't have to stand in again. I think we as an audience deserve that, because scientific publishing is one of the very, very few industries where European companies are leading. And I think, as this is a global industry, we deserve better than we sometimes get from our European friends, to also look at our interests, not just, but also, and not just take things that come from other regions who have nothing to lose, and take them as the new wisdom. The least we want is to be taken seriously. If we then to agree to disagree, that's fine, but it can't be because of lack of knowledge. And that's why I'm so pleased that at least we got one commissioner who has clearly shown an interest. It's probably coincidence she is Dutch. But Mrs. Kroes, she came, not only have we visited her on behalf of the SDM organization, but also she came this year to the Frankfurt Book Fair. She was kind enough also to pay a visit to the Springer stand, and of course I explained in 5 minutes everything that is right and everything that is wrong, including the solutions. So it can no longer be a lack of understanding of our industry. She claimed that she had learned a lot after the visit, but I'm pretty sure that the gentleman on the right has learned more at the Springer stand than Mrs. Kroes.
It was a very interesting visit.
Now, talk about the past. I already gave my comment on the past. In hindsight, it was an unbelievable period. The internet changed everything dramatically. We all know that. I'm exactly well positioned to make a judgment on that, because the internet was invented halfway through my career. So I've been living in the dark ages for half of my career and in the internet age for the rest of my career. And the balance is slightly shifting because every day, of course, the internet time increases. But in the old days, there's a few people around here probably who still remember those. It really was not good at all. When I joined the science publishing industry in 86, I was amazed, to be honest. It was a very strange industry, not similar to what we currently now know. The only thing similar there was that it was a growth industry. And that is so nice about this industry, and that's one takeaway. There might be problems with funding, there might be other problems, but this is one of the very, very few industries that has shown consistent growth over the last 50 and probably even more years. Science is something for the developed world, and as the world gets richer, there will be more money available for scientific research, and scientific research is very labor-intensive, and every new person is a new article every 2 years. There's nothing we can do about it, nothing we want to do about it, nothing we should be wanting to do about it. So there is a growth in science, and in fact, we have always struggled dealing with that growth. You can also have too much of a good thing. And that is the one thing that has haunted this industry, the success of its core product, scientific output. And that also explains why in, say, the mid-90s, the system really came to a grinding halt. When I joined the industry, we already were faced with 3%, 4%, 5% cancellations of subscriptions. And we publishers all compensated for that by just increasing the price by the same 5%, plus the volume growth, plus the inflation. That's 12. Let's be sure not to make a mistake. Let's make it 13% price increase. That was the business model in those days. And already in 86, within a week, I had learned the joke that it's pretty clear that one day every journal will end with one subscriber paying a million and the rest will photocopy. And the nice thing is we will still be profitable, was then the feeling in the publishing house. Yes, we might have been profitable, but it doesn't feel right. It doesn't. Feel right at the time. It never felt right, and it was certainly not in the interest of our customers. And as I said before, I'm becoming more and more old-fashioned. I believe in satisfied customers, and I can assure you that in the first half of my career, I never met a satisfied customer. That has dramatically changed. Customers are now satisfied. They're not all speaking up yet, but believe me, compared to 25 years ago, they are a happy lot. They're singing and dancing, cheerful, having access to everything, being grateful, being able to afford it. Compared to 25 years ago, our customers are living in heaven. And that means we are also living in heaven, in my opinion. But let's be aware that we keep our customers satisfied and let's keep on developing what we should be doing, that we will be doing. Anyway, the real breaking point, the acceleration point, the paradigm shift, to use that awful word, is the internet. There's no point denying that. And believe me, compared to all the new developments, and there's a lot of it being mentioned today, and I don't want to be unfriendly to all the follower speakers, but having said that, it is fiddling around the edges compared to the breakthrough of internet. That doesn't mean it's not important, it should be happening, but everybody talk about the new internet or social media, etc., etc., they all will have an impact, but it is peanuts compared to the basic internet. And one of my suggestions would be for the publishers in this room that, yes, keep an eye on these new developments, but get your act together on the principles of publishing. Get all your content online, including the archives, with the latest technology updated. That is priority number 1, 2, and 3. That's our role in life. And we should follow technology, but we don't have necessarily to invent this technology. We also didn't invent the internet, unfortunately. Although we would have been in a position if we would have been clever enough to do that. That is food for thought. Anyway, internet, 1998. June 1998, I took on my previous job. It was already carefully not mentioned, but for those of you who don't know me, I used to work for that friendly giant, Elsevier, from 98. And after 100 days, that's what modern management do. After 100 days, they draw their conclusions. So we assembled all the publishers in a building formerly known as a church. I mean, talking about an industry that has its difficulties. Religion, that's an industry in decline. We're on the up. Anyway, let's not be sidetracked. We were assembled in a church, and my conclusion after 100 days at that company at the time could be summarized in one slide, and I also talked 2 hours about that one slide, and it had only 3 words on it. It said fear and excitement. And fear, because what I then encountered, and I'm sure it wasn't any different in all the other scientific publishing houses, in the, say, late 90s, that when the internet was invented, we first saw it, I think that at all companies, with all of us, there was a mixed feeling. On the one hand, yes, there was fear. This cozy life of declining subscriptions, but growing revenues and a very comfortable life, let's face that, was under threat, under serious threat. And if we wouldn't have reacted, we would have not been sitting here anymore. Then new models would have taken over, and we would have had the same fate probably as the music industry or music companies to a great extent have. And the religion, I already mentioned. But we reacted because there was also, apart from fear, there was probably even more excitement in the room and in the company. Because deep down, it's sometimes forgotten, many people working for a scientific publishing house are scientists at heart. I started my career as a scientist. I miserably failed, but God bless Elsevier gave me a second chance. But it means we have either been scientists or we deal with scientists. Deep down, we have a very we like scientists. And if you don't like scientific community, you shouldn't be in this room. So we got an affinity with it. So we got very excited about the thought what internet could all be doing to us. And we all burned a lot of money reinventing the wheel, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But in the end, we got it working. And my God, has it been successful? I already talked about how pleased we should be there. So I think compared to the internet, everything else we will be seeing is peanuts, and we can concentrate again on our work, and that is publishing. And how publishing is affected is one of my stories. I think the issue is no longer about technology. We can leave that to the technologists. And when they invent something that is useful, let's apply it, but it won't be the change. The real innovation as an industry has been in our business model. I haven't put it on the slide because then all librarians start twittering again about my presentations, but I had one slide which had a heart-shaped format with the big deal in the middle. Because I love the big deal, I will defend it to my dying days. The big deal is the best invention since sliced bread. It changed the industry. I get already emotional about it, as you can hear. And if the big deal hadn't been invented, we should be inventing it now. Without the big deal, basically making use of technology in the business model sense, because innovation is not about technology alone. The most important innovations are based on new technology. You develop new products and new business models. And what this industry did together was get away very quickly from the single journal issue, single journal subscription issue with all its problems that we just described, and change it radically and offer the community a lot more for the same money. So we gave our customers who paid for the equivalent of CDs, who bought 10 CDs a year, we gave them more than 100,000 CDs, more than they ever could be wanting, basically for the same money. If we wouldn't have done that, other models would have been a lot more successful than they are. The other thing I think we did really well as an industry is to set our differences aside and use the momentum at 4 o'clock in the morning in Jimmy's bar at the Frankfurt Book Fair. So that's already enough reason to keep the book fair going. At 4 o'clock in the morning, the head of houses got together. I'm not sure what the Competition Commission would think of it, but probably so long ago that we can't be fined anymore. But if that's not long enough ago, I will deny it anyway. But because my memory is a little bit blurred at 4 o'clock in the morning, but my recollection is that we said, if we don't get our act together and if we don't connect our databases, first of all, we should all be heavily investing in this E. This is good for the customer. This is the way out for our customers of this ever the spiral of increasing prices and less access. So that's one. And then secondly, we should connect them in the back office so that people seamlessly jump from one article to the other. It's now all taken for granted, but it was a decision that needed to be taken at a certain point. And I think that was a momentous decision where we really put, based on our interest, but that's also what business is all about, but also we could see the benefits for our customers. Let's get going. And that is very important. In my opinion, we could have stopped there. I know this is not a fair statement, but we could have stopped there because I think the combination of the big deal plus repositories in reality means that the relevant audience has access to everything they want. If you ask the average subscriber, the average researcher, do you have open access? Yes, I have open access. They haven't got a clue what they say, but what they mean is, I have no problem in getting access to where I want. They all work in an environment, whether it's university or companies, where their employer makes sure they have access to everything. Having said that, the ghost was out of the bottle. When the internet came, of course, our enemies, if I may call them, or our colleagues who hated us, it's probably the same, or the scientists who hated us, thought, this is payback time, now we can do it without publishers, because the internet makes it all available. For a couple of years, we had some attempts where they took over the role of publishing. That was not very successful. And when it was successful, they discovered that publishing is not that difficult, but it's also rather tedious, and if you don't do it full time, it's you're bound to make mistakes, and why do it yourself? Why bake your own bread, we said before. So they said, okay, maybe it's not such a good idea that every scientist becomes his own publisher, but let's then change the business model, and that's where it really became interesting. That's what already was mentioned, open access came. Now, to be fair to myself, I've never been against open access. I was only forced to say for a couple of years I was against open access. But when I joined Springer, on day two, I had not changed my mind, but I had changed my voice, and I said, there's nothing wrong with open access. But then I also want the real stuff. Gold open access. Because gold open access is only a change of business model, no longer the researcher paying, no longer the librarian paying, but the researcher paying. I mean, it's the same research community. Who cares? And as long as the money comes to the publishers and we can make a living, who am I to resist people wanting to pay for my services? I mean, whatever next. So we said we are not against open access. We're also not in favor. We are neutral. We don't think it's really necessary, but I can also see that for some funding authorities in some fields, there is an overriding desire to better be safe than sorry, and let's make sure everybody has access, and then we want open access. So I have no problems with the Wellcome Trust of this world, who from the beginning put their money where their mouth was. I do have problems with green open access. It's not that I have been against it, because you don't want to upset your community, but it doesn't make sense. But if you want open access, you want open access. You don't want open access 6 or 12 months later, do you? I mean, what's that for kind of second-rate citizenship? Then be brave and make it available immediately. No, because we are not that brave, because it might cost money. Yeah, sometimes when you want something, it costs money. But if you're not prepared to put up money, then you should say, I'm not prepared to put up the money, and that's why I give you a delayed, a second-best solution. But then you should also say, not at my expense, but at the expense of the publishers. So I have no sympathy for do-gooders who do their do-good thing at my expense. I have no respect for that. I have a lot of respect for people who say, I want to change the business model, I want to destroy you, publisher, because you're a money shark, and I'm going to pay for it. That's fine. But saying you are lousy, you don't do a good job, and I'm going to change the system, but I'm not going to pay for it, I'll just take your money, your products away after a few months, I think it's easy and it's unacceptable. But as publishers, we are always having the difficulty getting the argument across. Here I'm among friends, so I speak open. But we all come across as defensive. We've got something to hide, we've got nothing to hide. We have a business to run, and the business is important that it keeps on running, because that's the continuity. So I would also encourage all policy to makers say, either do nothing and leave it to us, or put up money to change the system. But not a half-baked solution, because this access after 6 months, and whatever you research, Michael, with all due respect, and even when you find, all the users is in the first 6 months, and all the value created in the first 6 months, so after 6 months we can open it. First of all, why then open if there's no users anymore and no value? Begs belief, in my opinion. But it also reminds me of a research that we've researched, that every restaurant is open between 6 o'clock in the evening and after 10 o'clock, there are no more customers anymore in the restaurants. So let's make the food free after 10. Guess what will happen with these restaurants, and what will happen before 10? So that's I'm not a real intellectual, so I like simple comparisons, but sometimes it makes it clearer. Anyway. Last thing about open access, as I said, I love open access. We are the biggest open access publisher, so I'm now entitled to make also feel critical remarks. I'm convinced it is there to stay. I've always said that. I've always said it will be sometime maybe between 5% and 10% of the total. It might even become 15%, to let up the score a little bit. I think we are on the right track. It's clearly sustainable. It is a sustainable model. I wouldn't be surprised that over time in life sciences and the biomedical area, it might become the dominant model, but I'm also convinced it will not be completely taking over the business model. There is a model for the big deal or subscription-based, database-based, model. And that's maybe not a bad thing either, because unlike popular belief, open access is not the solution for the funding crisis that we are faced with. In fact, I guess that given the price increases of these big deals in the last 10 years, the cost per article have come down, whereas the cost per article in open access has gone up. So I think we're very close to these lines crossing. Because some people forget that if you have an open access fee that doesn't increase every year, yes, but with the volume increase, the overall cost of the system increase. And they increase more than the increase in the big deal. So before people knock the big deal, count your blessings. Good. This is This is what I think is the real challenge. Let's hope it is short, medium term and not long term. I think the challenge on business model is the jury is out. Everything is working well. We'll see how the market shares develop. I will follow it out of academic interest, but I no longer spend much time thinking about it. What I do think more about and worry a little bit, although I'm not a national worrier, is the funding crisis. We've been told this is a former bank building, and I take your word for it, this damage was done in the war and not during the financial crisis, but it is clear that the financial crisis is having a severe impact, not so much on the bankers themselves, as long as they have a job, but more on poor people, ordinary people like us. Because the financial crisis has turned into a government finance crisis, and a lot of our customers directly or indirectly depend on funding from governments. So whether we like it or not, that is reality, and we have to pay up for the bonuses of all these bankers. And that is a problem that will not go away. It is not a new problem. It only makes the existing problem bigger. The problem has always been, as I said in my first sentence, has always been that there is a growth in output, and we are faced with customers, and that's a good thing. There's not many other industries that have it. In our customers, in their ideal world, they would like to buy all our products. We never have to convince our customer that you should be wanting this product, because in their ideal world, they have everything. And with the big deal, they have everything, but that's something different. And so that is a problem that they could never buy as much as their budget allowed. And then the budget grew every year less than the increase in volume, so the problem got a little bit bigger every year. I think in the last 10 years, the problem hasn't increased. Everybody's worried about, yes, but if the big deal becomes more expensive, and when can we afford it? I think through sheer necessity, all of us publishers have, when we are honest, we are struggling to increase the revenue of the big deals significantly. If you have any increase in the big deal you have with customer, it is an increase that is clearly below the combination of inflation and volume growth. We're talking about low single-digit growth. That is the new reality. That's something I think we have to accept and we can live with. And there's nothing wrong in a situation that budget constraints at the customer end means that we have to increase our efficiency a few percent every year. That should be doable, and I see for the medium term a solution that we can increase, say, the revenues by 2, 3, 4% max, which is probably lower than the volume growth and certainly well below the combination of volume growth and inflation. There's nothing wrong with that. It means the customer can afford it, and we still have a living. This is also not to be taken for granted. So I'm reasonably positive about that new equilibrium. What we have as a challenge is that the world is changing, and that is also good, because we don't mind whether the scientist operates from Brazil, China, or from Gütersloh. Now, Gütersloh is probably not a good example, is it? No. Are there any scientists in Gütersloh? Is it? Publishers are there. No, let's not mix them. No. So that is true, but it is also true that certainly, as far as I know from my company, we are struggling to let them pay their fair share. That is the problem with these increases, is the base where you start from has a big impact. And countries like China and Brazil, etc., were used to paying, or India, were used to paying very little. And I think that their increase in gross national product has been steeper than the increase in money available to pay us. Now, that's also a problem that can be solved as long as they pay a little bit extra, a little bit more than say, poor German customers. Then it is probably a problem that over time will be solved, But it is an issue. It is an issue that I think that some of these very successful emerging countries have a bit of a free ride in this database model, whereas if we had true golden open access, they would have been paying a lot more. It's also food for thought. But, as I said, I'm not going to be here at my probably last presentation. That's why it was named Past, Present and Future. Let's not take the risk. He will be no longer around in a couple of years, Arnoud thought, probably. So that's why I want to start on also a positive note. We have been growing for the last 25 years. Maybe not always in profit, not by everybody, but we are still a very profitable industry that has experienced growth for 25 consecutive years. There's not many other industries who can say that. Usage is going through the roof, and I don't know whether unit costs are reasonable, yes or no, but I do know that they are declining rapidly. So if they didn't have a good deal 25 years ago, they certainly have now a less worse deal or an excellent deal. It's getting better every year. And this is probably also in the interest of our traditional customers, who we probably have to accept the predicament they're in. Because of the new technology, because of us changing from paper subscriptions to journals into a database model, we should be becoming more interesting to what we then call non-core customers. In our company, the sales to industry and bodies like that are clearly increasing more than to the core academic market from, of course, a lower base, but it's increasing rapidly. And we probably have to do more, even more, to make the product attractive to that from origin non-core customer, because the average industry was always interested in some of our stuff, but not in everything. And they certainly didn't want to take out a subscription and build up a collection. But we now can go to them and say, here's a database, it's an academic database, so 90% might be rubbish for you, it's highly valuable to academics, but 10% is maybe very, very relevant to you, so why don't you pay for those 10%? Now, we've had some success with it. It's not an easy sell because people don't like to pay for something when 90% is not relevant to them, so we are experimenting with business models, but what we see is increased success and also increased usage also in industry, and that hopefully will help us to keep on growing our companies, although we are struggling in our core market. There's more to be made there, and maybe that technology can help a little bit. One product that I would like to mention is the archives. I'm sure in between those 7 years, I know there were many conferences where archiving was a big issue. It's no longer an issue, apparently, because it's not on the agenda. And it was a hot topic. I've never got excited about archiving, because why would we not archive? Why we want to stay in business for a long time. But of course, I understand that customers have to be better safe than sorry. Sorry, so we had all these archiving policies to back up. But I think it makes perfect sense from a business point of view, and also we owe it to our industry that we should do all the archiving ourselves in the best possible manner. You are shortchanging your customers and yourself if you don't make your own archives available, and not a quick and dirty Google type job, but a real thing, a live archive. Over time, it pays for itself, but from day one, it increases your usage and the customer satisfaction. So I think you owe it to your customer. I think by now everybody has archived the journal past. At Springer, we've started also digitizing all the books we ever published. And again, there, all the books, so not just when there's more than one print of the book. We take all the various editions because we want to have a complete archive and do a really good old-fashioned quality job in the hope that there will be interest to buy these archives. At the end of the day, we are not a foundation, And I'm sure there will be interest. How much we don't know, but I do know it is good for the industry. So it is good for Springer and good for our reputation. So there is a future for the archives. I'm less sure about the future of another buzzword I keep on hearing, workflow tools. I always have been skeptical, so I have to admit that. I can only smile when some people claim, or their publishing house proudly claim, we now employ more software engineers than publishers. God help you over the bridge, I would say, for that company. Whatever next. But at the end of the day, whether we like it or not, we are a publishing house. There might be room for software tools, but are we then best positioned to develop them? And of course, I'm not against workflow tools, but the best workflow tool is the internet. And I also don't deny that ISI Web of Science and Scopus are excellent workflow tools. Nothing wrong with it. But I don't see a golden future in all of us spending a lot of energy on tiny little software products where you have to ask yourself, are we the best to develop them, as I said, but also that advance you have there might be taken over by somebody else tomorrow. That's the other thing. And thirdly, even when there is a good product with the market, there is a finite universe of people that then buy it. Is it really a profitable exercise? So in my ideal world, we don't waste our time on workflow tools. I know it sounds old-fashioned. Maybe I got it completely wrong, but so be it. But at our company, the adagium is we focus on content and we will apply tools that are available. But I wish everybody success who thinks that I really am now past my sell-by date. And there's only one thing certain, we save a lot of money and a lot of energy on not doing it. And I've probably upset a few people in my own company who are working on workflow tools, but... So, rounding off, I think there is horses for courses, and you can't change tech every few years. We are in the publishing industry, and then what you should be doing is publishing. And focus on content, and apply bells and whistles, but don't develop them yourself as the next holy grail. And there's no point moaning about the library budget situation. It's a reality. It will not change. And better make it work, lower your cost, and become more efficient. Together, we have to be firm with the development, firm but friendly, of course, because they are customers, and it's not everybody in the same boat. But they can't say, why do I pay 10% extra when UK customers only pay 4 or 5% extra? They are even richer, that kind of stuff. Yes, but they pay a lot more. And we can't eat from percentages. We can only eat from real money. And sometimes 10% is a lot less than 2% increase for an existing customer. So I think that is an educational exercise. We have to keep on doing that. I think if you really want to innovate and not just a follower looking at what Springer does, I think this was a joke, folks. if you really want to be an innovator, think of new business models, experiment with new business models. There's more to be gained there than focusing on technology. And that is where the music industry lost it. They didn't develop the right business model. Technology is all there. I think sometimes people say, yeah, but you're still very profitable. That's true. And whether you call it profits or surpluses with societies, it's still true. But let's be pleased, we were also profitable because that's also the reason why we were able to invest so much and we're not dependent on public funding. And at Springer, we certainly invested in the last 5 years more than in the 50 years before that. So, as the last slide, because I think I've now filled enough time for the lunch, the organizer. As last thing, don't be ashamed of calling yourself a publisher. That's what we are good at, that's what we should be doing. Focus on content and focus on the best model, business model to get it to the end customer, and don't be carried away by technology. I don't want to ruin the day for all the technology people after me, but I'm entitled to give my vision as a kickoff. So that's my last statement. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have a little while for some questions. Arno, do we have microphones for the audience? Can I ask people who want to ask questions, could you please stand up and could you say both your name and your affiliation? Do we have a first question for Derek? You stumbled into submission.
Yeah, that's easy then.
Oh, we do. Fred Diller.
Good morning. I enjoyed your talk tremendously. I'm sure we all did. Could you comment without getting us in trouble on antitrust regulations about your thoughts about charging for archives? I mean, libraries are traditional archivists, and I think you've urged us as publishers that we produce the content, we disseminate the content, we should take full responsibility for the content. So that costs money to do that. So should there be one-time charges, or should there be occasional charges for maintenance? What are your thoughts on that without getting us into trouble about pricing discussions?
Now, I can only say what our model is, because sometimes you have to offer a model that is feasible and not the model that is most logical. The world is not driven by logic alone. The world is also driven by emotions. And I agree with you, it would be logical that now with a database model, we would charge people a fee for new content, and we would charge them a maintenance fee for all content already in there. But I think all attempts to do that have been in vain, and it's, in my opinion, also not necessary. Let's keep it simple. We are not selling to different customers every year. We're selling it to the same customers. And in our business model, we have just to accommodate that in the price increase that we are able to pull off every year, that also covers the maintenance of the database. What's wrong with that? One bill. Big deal, one amount. So let's not, but I think my major contribution in all the companies that I work with is not inventing something, not thinking of new complications, but because there's many intelligent people, but to keep it simple. But if you looked at the first pricing model for Science Direct, I mean, you needed a PhD to understand this. So I didn't understand it because I failed my PhD. And so, and if I can't understand who works with that full time, although maybe not very clever, who is then the customer to understand this? So I think we always have to work for simple models. So no maintenance fees for the database because people feel it doesn't feel right. And there's no budget, operate with an existing budget. And we've done the same for archives, a one-off fee. Is that logical? No, it's not logical. But there's also benefits, because if they buy the archives, there's also more usage, and there's also justification to accept the price increase. So indirectly, there is a benefit of having the archives there. But keep it simple. If you can't understand, explain your business model to your own children in 5 minutes, then you're probably wrong. And I would leave it like that. Thank you.
Another question for Derek?
I have one, actually, Derek, which was dawning on me as you were talking about the way in which the big deal was a fantastic arrangement, because it was reconnecting with users, it was overcoming the serials crisis problems in some respects. Do you feel that when we do reach, as I assume we must, that downloads will start to level off as all of the countries get into a certain level of development? Do you not see us going back to that same dark old world of paper, where we're finding it difficult to offer greater value because the number of downloads is not continuing to go up.
Yeah, I mean, the value is not just downloads, it's also the sheer availability of more content. At Springerlink, because of journals and books, we add 15,000 pages every day. That is worth something. And not at the same day, 15,000 old pages become worthless. So the addition adds something. I agree, the addition has also so far resulted in a tremendous increase. I see no reason why, because of the additional content, there should be a continued increase, but the steep increase will probably level off. That's almost by definition. Maybe that has an impact on the readiness of customers to keep on paying more for the database. That's then our problem. We have to convince them or accept there will not be an increase. Going back to dicing and slicing and giving people less is in nobody's interest. It's not in the interest of the customer. It is not in our own interest, because then I would really even have more sympathy for an open access movement and say, do it then and overcome all the barriers you still have. Let's not go back. And now we get a technical question. I'm lost.
not the technical one here. Anthony Watkinson, Cyber Research. We mentioned books, and I was interested in Springer and books, because Springer is a very big and important book publisher. Books are more exciting than they were, I think. What do you feel about books? You weren't a book person at Elsevier, surely, were you? You got rid of a lot of them, didn't you?
No, just to correct the history, I didn't get rid of books at Elsevier. I was never allowed to publish books. Books were a four-letter word, and our chairman then always said, if you want to publish books, do it in your own time, and by the way, we pay you enough money to do it. And at that time, that was probably a correct statement, because the business model for books is as unattractive as the business model for journals, print journals was. So at that time, you should focus on print journals. Books, I think we all have an emotional bond with books. It's clear that print books alone will not pay the bill. So far, so good on the combination of print plus e. We now have a clearly profitable program. We are selling e-books, again, in big deals. Sorry, I wasn't able to invent anything new. It has an impact on the print sales. Whether it's overall but overall it's a plus. How sustainable that plus is, how big that plus is, remains to be seen. But for us, it was also a no-brainer, because continuing with print books is certainly a dead-end street. So better make the most out of e. But I'm sure that books will be there. E-books have given book a new lease of life. But it's also sure that even with e-book, it will never be as profitable as e-journals, because the cost per page are lower, the acquisition costs are higher, and to add insult to injury, you have to pay the author as well, although you might not make a profit. Life is really unfair sometimes. But we will continue books because it's our reputation.
Okay, gentleman here at the front.
Yeah, Aldo Rampioni from Springer. I have a question. I'm interested in how to optimize the unit costs. No, they are decreasing, but where is the strategies to decrease the unit costs? Where there is more space to improve the situation? Would you work on the technology? Would you work more on the organizations within the company?
Yeah.
Would you work more on business model? I don't know.
I don't know either, but what I do know is that bringing down unit cost is very important, because it helps the conversation with our customers. Who's to say a certain amount is too little or too much? But when what you get every year for that amount gets better, customers are bound to be less dissatisfied than they otherwise would have been. So I think bringing down unit cost is very important. For that, it's important that you add more content, because the more content you add, the more users there is. That's unavoidable. But also, you have to invest in technology, or at least you have to apply technology. But also there, we're currently working on a new version of Springer Link. Priority number 1, 2, and 3 is download speed, and not so much new library things or personalize your own database or whatever we could all think of. It is just plainly, as long as if you can bring your download speed down by 1%, you get more usage and more downloads. So, and only when we're all convinced on that point we have a maximum score, let's then go into other bells and whistles. So you have to be accurate, it has to be complete, it has to be high quality, it has to be easy accessible, because the average customer, the average number of downloads comes from the odd student who hasn't got a clue how it all works. He just prints. And when it then takes too long to download, he just stops. So I think that's the most gain to be had there. Let's not just focus on the top 5% of real research who know how all these systems work. The average customer, the average, the overwhelming majority of all these downloads come from occasional users who work with Google, and that's it then.
Yes, gentleman over there.
Yes, I'm Ralf Schimmer, Max Planck Digital Library, Munich, Germany. I would like to focus on your open access gold ideas and what you said about this. Open access gold seems to become into the forefront in various discussion rounds. For instance, at the last Berlin conference on open access in November in Washington, this was also a clear outcome that open access gold would be the topic of the time. And in the Max Planck Society, for instance, we also try to get our act together, as you said, to go for the real stuff. And I think Bernard Schurz in this afternoon's APE lecture will elaborate on this a little bit. I would take this observation that open access gold is becoming a major theme as a starting point for further questions, because then I think we all have the challenge. All means the publishing industry, as well as the intermediaries, as well as the customers on the library side, for instance, or the universities, the research organizations at large, to reinvent some of the processes. For instance, when I look at our existing reality, now we have a big deal as the Max Planck Society with Springer. So this is one single point of negotiations, can be complex and take some while, but then we have a multi-year agreement, and so we have to revisit this, well, after on larger intervals. But on the publishing side, we know that we have more or less around 600 publications with Springer, journal publications with Max Planck affiliation. And on a total, we have about 10,000 journal publications in the Max Planck Society. So with 600 with Springer, so that doesn't sound like a single point of contact, a single kind of invoicing, etc. So there's a big challenge in the system. And also for the publishers, I think you know how to organize the selling of subscriptions or of journals. That's the packaging of articles, and it's also a packaging for marketing. So you have a list price, and the intermediaries or direct customer relations. All the roles have been learned and practiced and exercised for many, many years, decades, with certain changes and evolution. But this seems to be a new challenge, and I think there can be a lot of trial and error, a lot of reinventing the wheel, a lot of inefficiency or efficiency in the system. And I'm wondering whether if we all think that open access gold is the sign of the time, whether it's not about time to establish some form of global steering or advisory or pioneering committee group or something populated by actors from various sectors, the publishing industry, academic institutions, perhaps also in the media, in order to develop some technical requirements, recommendations, set of standards, etc. And kind of replicating the work that has been done in areas such as counter, where it was also populated from various sides to develop some standards. And or now with ORCID and other things, where there was a certain need I felt and identified, and a principle of practice established in order to how this can be approached and how this could be advanced. Because I think if everybody is left alone as an institution or as a publisher, so there seems to be enormous costs involved and a high risk of finding a non-optimal solution and taking a longer path before something more efficient and better working could be instrumentalized.
Yeah, it's certainly a valid observation, and I don't want to say I told you so, but I'm saying it anyway, because when people were, when first open access came around, and that's also the reason, to be honest, that I changed my tack, joking aside, on open access, because I was absolutely sick and tired of people from the propaganda machine of open access and taking the moral high ground, and the traditional publishers were the dinosaurs who were not prepared to move. And that was not a climate where we could have an open debate on the pros and cons of the database model versus the open access model. I agree that by now the debate is less heated, it's more open on practicalities, and maybe it is an idea to say, if you really want to make this work, is there room for inter-publishing or even between publishing houses and research institutes, cooperation that goes beyond the individual profit and loss line. I think it's an interesting food for thought, and maybe something we can pick up. But for the time being, I think this might be the time to consider it, because I think by now most publishers have some kind of hybrid model at least, and it's probably worth it. Thanks. Okay.
If I can make an observation with my STM hat on, we have actually made proposals to the Commission that there should be a consultation or a network of excellence project looking into these issues, because I think the infrastructure issue is a major one that needs to be dealt with. Yeah. And it may be best dealt with in a collaborative environment where we're all talking together about what infrastructure would need to be in place and how we can best encourage that. I think there's time for just one more question. And I see a man with his hand going up immediately.
Thank you. Claudio Aspidi, Sanford Bernstein. How do you reconcile your statement that your customers are happy with Robert Darnton's Three Jeremy's article in the New York Times and the New York Review of Books from end of 2010, complaining loudly about the cost and impact of subscription prices on the budgets of academic libraries?
Now, I mean, you as a scientist should know better that a sample of one or two is not a verdict. I'm sure that say 20 years ago there were also some satisfied customers, but the majority wasn't. And we do two things. One is I travel around and I speak to a lot of customers. I can sense the mood. And secondly, we measure it consistently, feedback from our customers, what they think. And I can assure you both observations, one is personal, the other is systematic, are pointing in the right direction. And of course, you can't expect that everybody's happy with what they get, and I don't expect them to fall on their knees from gratitude and say, how could we ever be so nasty to you? That's not the issue. But I also don't accept the fact that we haven't improved and that it hasn't been noticed by the overwhelming majority of the customers. These are the facts. And I'm sure you can point to another article in The Guardian or whatever. That's fine, but I would like to stick to the facts. I do believe in research, and research shows that customers are now less dissatisfied or more happy than in the past. Sorry for that.
Well, if we can say thank you to Dirk again for being so open with the questions.